Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam dadah.
Waalaikumsalam,
Salam dadah.
How are you? Dah semua kan ni belum? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Ada seorang lagi dadah.
Who? Siapa nama? Tak ada nama kat sini kan, seorang.
Solhi. Dadah, dadah, dadah. Nanti dah. Sekejap lagi masuk. Okay.
Sorry, it's on the way later.
Kenapa?
He's on the way.
On the way to Zoom, nak naik apa? Alright, so let's begin with Umar Kitab Al-Fatih. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alright, this is group 2 kan ya? Group 2. Okay, recorded. Apa week 6 ni sekarang? Leader Jazli kan? Atau Aklan lah, boleh jawab.
Apa, sorry tak ada?
Week berapa ni? Week 5 ke week 6?
Week 4 tak ada.
Oh, week 4. You can clear, hear my voice clearly kan? You can listen?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, so week 4. Next week kan apa nama? Another 3 weeks ya next week ya?
Yes.
No Natal and then 2 weeks face to face. 3 weeks. 2 weeks ya. Alright. So, itulah basically for year 5 as usual lah. Before, even before MCO kan we had we have met one time kan during yang first day briefing tu.
If I'm mistaken. Session about birth trauma.
Ha, itulah birth trauma and I give some briefing kan. Okay lah, but apa with MCO ni memang ada some changes buat di apa requirement lah, buat di apa continuing assessment kan. Logbook is no more there. You only need to apa submit case summary tu, and then yeah marks from case presentation and seminar presentation, and another marks itulah to replace logbook tu lah yang di procedures presentation. You already did with your mentor kan, or belum?
Yes.
Okay. Procedures tu you need to know lah. Actually for year 5 actually if possible ya you need to assist. Lah nanti tengok juga. Tapi lah we don't have any what work anymore kan. For nanti yang week 6 and week 7 tu only apa? Only bedside teaching only kan. No more what work. So you go to the ward or clinic only for teaching. Okay lah, so for the procedures, just only your presentation. Your mentor siapa nih, group 2 nih?
Saya.
Dr. Syahle ya. Okay, next week pun you will meet him lah. For neonatal teaching, neonatal examination. Alright, so ini group 2. Ini ada Akilah ni. Akilah mana Akilah ni?
Saya, doktor.
Ah, itulah susah sangat nak. Apa? Nak WhatsApp saya, WhatsApp yang last week tak reply. Semalam WhatsApp lagi tak tanya, nak tanya apa? Nak tanya boleh ke tak ya? For tomorrow itulah prepare to use Google Meet lah, Gmeet Meet, because apa? Our UIA Google account ni boleh can apa? Can accommodate up to 150. Prof Marzuki dah kata.
Tapi is it okay with doktor sebab doktor yang have to approve bila ada orang masuk tu doktor kena admit seorang-seorang lah.
Okay, nanti lah nanti cuma saya yang create the meeting room apa need me or nanti lah I will ask apa Farah lah the PA of pediatric tu untuk create the meeting room.
Okay boleh doktor
okay.
Boleh.
So she will apa nama? She will jaga lah, she will take care lah.
Okay. Boleh tak?
Alright. So, who gonna be present today? Siapa?
Me, doktor. InsyaAllah.
Aklan, eh? One case only, kan? Kau ada two cases ke apa-apa?
I prefer the case two if time permits.
Kita tengoklah how it goes lah for the apa first case ni. So you Aklan, you got the case ni from where?
Previous case saya lah, doktor.
Oh, okay. So memang doktor saya kan you cari sendiri kan macam mana?
Sorry, doktor.
You got from Dr. Seth ke you just apa?
Saya cari, collect from the previous bank
group. Oh, bank. Your bank ke?
Yeah. Our batch bank.
Oh, yeah, okay. Alright. So, mana you don't meet the patient, ya? Yeah? Okay lah. Alright, just start the present. Alright, proceed.
Alright. Just a second, there.
Sorry.
That.
Oh, you have apa screen? You have apa share screen?
Yes, that.
Okay. Alright.
Okay, so assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh to Dr. Taufik and my beloved friends. So inshallah today I will be the presenters for today's sessions of long case. So my name is Muhammad Aklan. So inshallah I will present this case today. So this is my case profile. So it's taken from case right up from the previous group. So the patient name is NAM, 12 years old Malay boys, and it was the clerk on the day 5 of admission. So I was given the chance to review a case setup of a patient, 12 years old Malay boys with no known medical illnesses, currently on day 5 of admission. So the patient initially presented with a history of fever and multiple migrating joint pain for the past 12 days duration. So the patient was appearing well until about 12 days prior to admission, where the patient developed episodes of fever. So the fever was persistent for the entirety of 12 days. It was described to be low grade with no chills nor any rigor. So the highest recorded temperatures was 38 degrees Celsius, where the patient recorded it in one of the KK, in KK Maran. And the patients actually took paracetamol as what is prescribed by the KK, and the fever was partially alleviated by the PCM. And also the mothers also put the patients on sponging in order to alleviate the fever. So the fever was actually in association with episodes of joint pain. So the joint pains was involving multiple joints. So it started initially with bilateral hip joints, which occurs concurrently with the first day of fever. So the pain was described to be sharp and pricking in nature. It was localized over the bilateral left and right hip joints, non-radiating, with a pain score initially was mild, about 4 to 5 out of 10. So initially, it did not disturb his gait, but it disturbed his sleep during the initial phase of his illness. However, patient did not notice any noticeable warmness, swellings, or any skin changes overlying the bilateral hip joint. So on the third day of illness, or third day of fever, the patient suddenly develops episodes of right knee pain. So the knee pain on the right side is of similar characteristic, sharp and pricking in nature, localized, non-radiating. And the pain score was only was also about the same, 4 to 5, and also did not disturb his gait, but disturbed his sleep. Patients, however, started to notice that there is some evidence of swelling and also redness overlying the right knee. And as described by the mothers, that the knee, swollen right knee, will be painful whenever it is touched, and also massaged by the mothers. So on subsequently, on the 7th day of fever, patient then started to develop episodes of left knee pain after the resolutions of the right knee pain. So it is of similar characteristic with the previous joint pain, where it is also associated with some swelling, skin changes, and also it is painful on touch. So on subsequently, on 7th day of illness, patient then started to have pains over the right shoulders and elbows. It is of similar characteristic. However, patient did not notice any noticeable erythemas, swellings, or any painful on touch. So previously, before this onset of multiple migrating joint pains, patient have no instrumentations or any traumas to the affected joints. So patients actually took PCM as was prescribed by KK. Patient actually went to KK 4 times during this period of 12 days duration. So however, the PCM was only alleviate the pain temporarily, and the pains will recur whenever the effects of the PCM has gone off. So the pain score in general, it worsens as days go by. And on the day of admissions, which is on the 12th day of fever, the patient was unable to walk properly, and patient the mother described the patient to be limping and requiring assistance to ambulate to the KK. Okay. So otherwise, patients have no noticeable abnormality of movements. Patients have no palpitations. There is no noticeable skin rashes over the bodies. And patients have no noticeable lumps over the extensive surface of the limbs. Patients and the guardians, however, was unsure of any antecedent upper respiratory infections, histories prior to the current presentations of fever and joint pain. Patients have no histories of any previous symptoms that might suggest acute gastroenteritis, for example, abdominal pains or loose stool, or any respiratory symptoms such as shortness of breath, fevers, and cough that might suggest underlying pneumonias that might cause a reactive arthritis. Patient also did not hail from a dengue endemic regions. There was no history of any retroorbital pains, frontal headaches, myalgia, skin rashes. Patients did not complain of any bleeding tendencies or any vomiting or diarrheal episodes during the courses of illness. Patients also did not complain of any jaundice, cough, and lumbar pains, conjunctival secretions, contact with rat-infested waters, or any history of any jugular tracking that might suggest a leptospirosis infection. There is no family history of any autoimmune disease running in the families, and patients have no noticeable facial malar rash. There is no noticeable hair loss. There is no noticeable ulcers over the oral regions. And patients did not complain of any anemic symptoms such as lethargies, fatigue, palpitations, and also shortness of breath. And there was no bleeding tendency. Patient also did not notice any non-blanching rashes over the gravity-dependent areas, in specifically to the lower limbs and buttocks. Patient also did not complain of any abdominal pains or any mucosal edema. So throughout the entirety of the 12 days duration, patient have no symptoms that might suggest of complications of the presenting illness, in which patient have no symptoms of heart failure such as shortness of breath, bilateral pedal edemas, and also reduced effort tolerance and requiring extra pillows in order to sleep at night. So because of the duration of illness, patient was actually brought to KK Marans for about 4 times during the entirety of 12 days. So for each subsequent visit, patient was actually given PCM and reassured and was told to come again if necessary. However, because of the persistence of the symptoms during the 4 presentations, patient was then referred to Hoshas for continuation of care. So during the admissions to emergency departments, ECG was done. Patient was unsure of the exact results, but patient was told by the doctors that it was unremarkable. Blood test was done. Patient was, however, was unsure of the results. Dengue test was also done by the emergency departments. It was negative as reported, and patient was then kept in ward for further management of his current problem. So for system review, aside from representative symptoms, patients is otherwise unremarkable for the other systems. As for the past medical and surgical history, this is actually the second admission. The first admission was also in Hoshas. It was about 3 years ago, where the patient was admitted 3 days for pneumonia. Patient then completed antibiotics, symptoms then resolutes, then the patient was then discharged with no complications. There is no history of any surgery done. Patients, as mentioned before, was unsure of any preceding antecedent URTI symptoms prior to the current presentations. And also forgot to mention that patient have no similar presentations in the past. As of now, drug and allergy histories, aside from the PCM prescribed by the KKMRN, patients have no other drug intake, and patients have no known drug allergies, no known food allergies. Immunization history was up to date, all of it.
Aklan?
Yes, sir.
Let me stop here.
Yes.
Right, so we take some discussion. I want to clarify that how many days was the fever?
12 days, doctor.
12 days, yeah. Okay, so tanya ini, Niswa dulu. Niswa, so what is your working diagnosis?
From the history given by Aklan just now, with fever and showing the migratory joint pain. So I will think of the acute rheumatic fever first.
Because okay, sudah nampak dah kalau you tengok di slide tu, dah nampak di title acute rheumatic fever ya. Alright. By the way, you already know the case or tak tahu ni sebelum we discuss ni?
Nah. Oh. Tak tahu.
Okay, ya. Yeah? Alright. So, itulah. Our professional diagnosis should be ERF, ya, erythematic fever. Okay, so in regards to this apa this disease, do you want to ask anything more to Aklan? So how do you establish the diagnosis, Nisma? Ya, ada demam 12 hari, ada migratory joint pain. What else should you ask?
I would like to ask any other symptom that can such as for the other, because Aklan actually said that for the other system is remarkable. However, I still want to ask about any cardiovascular from the cardiovascular symptom that may, because in ERF can manifest as cardiitis as well. Okay. So I'd like to ask any cardiovascular symptom, and then
yeah, any symptom of cardiitis lah. So how do you establish the diagnosis of ERF though? Very simple kan? Apa?
Two major symptom or one major with one minor?
Yeah, using Jones criteria. Either two major or one major plus two minor with evidence of streptococcal infection. Yeah, post streptococcal infection. Alright, so the major symptom there are five kan? So the carditis. So nak tanya apa carditis tu? Carditis symptom. Untuk teori kan kat buku tulis carditis. So nak tanya apa tu patient? So you ada carditis tak? Tak tahu lah patient. How old is the patient tadi? 12 kan. Okay, chest pain. One.
Palpitation, doctor. The expert mentioned that it mostly myocarditis would manifest as palpitation.
Yes.
And then pericarditis can also present. So there will be a sharp pain and then alleviated by leaning forward. I forgot to inquire.
So no chest pain, no palpitation, ya? Kau ada, Aklan?
No chest pain, no palpitation. Alright.
So no carditis, ya? Next, apa lagi, Ineswa?
Polyarthritis, or migratory arthritis, or dah ada tadi, ya?
Dah ada. Okay, next.
And then chorea, the movement, the involuntary move. Okay.
Aklan, dah explain tadi?
This patient have no abdominal movement as noticed by the guardian and also by the patient.
Okay. Next.
And then the erythema, the presence of rash, erythema marginatum, as well as subcutaneous nodule.
Okay, tak ada ya? Alright. Okay. Last kali apa? Nodule tadi. Okay, alright. Dah already 5. So, maknanya major criteria is only one ya?
Major criteria so far only one, doctor.
Yes, alright. Okay, so we need some minor criteria. Siapa ni next? Solhi. Apa nak tanya apa minor criteria? Soalnya hilang.
Sorry, Dr. Ada. For minor criteria, there are few minor criteria, which includes CRP, increase in CRP.
The one who present in the patient apa dulu? Dia presented with fever kan?
Yes, fever.
Fever satu. Next, CRP. Kau tak apa, tanya untuk Aklan, CRP result ada?
CRP ada, doktor. I will
positive ya. Tak apa ya, display dulu. Kita discuss sikit-sikit je. CRP positif ya.
Positif, doktor.
CRP positif. Apa lagi soalan ni?
ESR.
Ya, samalah. ESR CRP kan one point ya.
Positif. Next. Arthralgia.
Arthralgia we already put in major kan. Ada migratory joint pain tu. Dah major, maknanya no need to put in minor. Tak boleh kira double. Dah letak in major, jangan letak in minor. So two minor actually already there kan. But lagi anything else minor other?
Prolonged PR interval, leukocytosis.
Okay. Satu-satulah. PR interval maknanya you buat ECG kan. Aklan ECG dia apa?
Unremarkable ada. Ada just a result.
Okay, and then tadi leukocytosis, FBC dia.
This is the normal, doctor.
Okay. Anything else, Solhi?
Okay.
So, betul lah, Aklan. Minor only two, ya, maknanya. Fever
and CRP.
CRP ya. Okay. Okay. So we need lagi satu to confirm, we need apa jadi evidence of
streptococcal infection.
So apa result Adlan?
The ASOT titer was elevated more than fourfold time.
400 mana ya?
Ah yes.
1 to 400 ya. Okay. So yang signifikan kalau
but the throat swab was negative for culture.
So okay lah, ASOT is adequate lah to treat this case lah. So actually this case is confirm lah. We treat as acute rheumatic fever with arthritis only kan, without apa, chondritis.
Yes,
okay. So next Hazirah Nur Hazirah nih. Can on presentation when the patient has tadi fever and apa namanya joint pain tadi. So what else you should think about the differential? What differential diagnosis you should think?
If it's because the patient presented with joint pain, so we have to think of the differential diagnosis of joint pain, arthritis. Yeah. First, I would think of autoimmune disease, such as systemic lupus erythematosus.
Sel ini laki ke perempuan? Siapa tadi Aklan?
Laki.
Laki kan, so unlikely lah. Janganlah letak awal-awal SLE. Apalagi pikir yang lagi simple buat di arthritisnya apa? Lagi satu sistem apa? Immune disease.
GIA, Doktor?
GIA, ya. So, creator of GIA. Apa, Hazira? Ingat tak? Hazira ke siapa tadi? Mana
hilang? Ingat.
Aklan?
Ingat.
Apa kriteria diagnosis of GIA?
GIA. Saya tengok dulu.
Simple je, chronic urinary arthritis. Dia pasti juvenile tu, dia pasti in children less than 18 years. And then karena chronic recurrent dia kena ada kriteria of apa namanya period dia kena more than 6 weeks. This case kan only 12 days kan.
Mm-hmm.
So in past medical tak ada kan. Sometimes acute tapi recurrent lah. Kalau maybe 6 weeks ago pernah kena, sekarang kena kena. There we need to put GIA as differential. But in this case kan unlikely. Ya? Nah. Dah apa sudah confirm dah rheumatic fever, tapi tak apalah. In early tu kita pikirkan possible system, apa autoimmune GIA SLE. Okay. Jazli, what else should you think? Nak fikir apa lagi differential? Ada-ada je kat situ history tadi. Aklan dah present banyak. Apa ni? Nak fikir apa lagi?
I think it could be more common because patient presented with fever and anemia. Could be dengue, but it's too long. But the fever is for 12 weeks. So 12 days.
Yes, you are right. Yeah. So dengue ni dia 2 to 7 days je. Dah 12 hari, janganlah fikir dengue. So nak tanya balik Aklan ni. KK ni dia test dengue tu on day 12 of illness ni ke masa dulu-dulu awal presentation?
Yang tu tak ada dalam write up Dr. Susi, tak, I cannot certain the fact.
Kalau dah day 12, dah
sakit on, 12 hari. On to ED, dia buat tinggi tu, dia repeat balik. Tapi before
12 that, yes, if still fever is for 12 days and then you still think about dengue, it is not, yeah, possible, tapi it is not the right way of thinking. For dengue tu usually acute. For day 2 to day 7 of fever. Kalau more than day apa 7 days, we need to think other diseases. Possible dengue, maybe usually dia kalau after 7 days still persistent apa namanya pain tu masih ada, tapi the fever should be resolved. Unless kalau complicated with septicemia for example, which is actually a severely ill patient. Boleh je demam sampai more than 7 days, tapi kalau only dengue, dia the natural history of the disease will be settled back fever lah. Acute illness, first 3 days febrile phase and then apa defervescent phase and then apa convalescent tu demam lagi sikit, 7-8 days should be resolved.
Apart from that, my differential will be septic arthritis doctor because of the presence of the arthralgia and the fever. However, patient does not have history of trauma, which is one of the common cause for OM. And I so this that's my negative point for septic arthritis in this case.
Sometimes not only trauma, memang common is trauma, but sometimes ya poor hygiene pun ada aja. I got few cases of septic arthritis ya, yeah, memang karena pure hygiene. Poor hygiene dia apa skin infection and then develop arthritis sampai possible ya.
Yes. In septic arthritis, because the patients have polyarthritis. So in textbook mentioned that in such cases we must consider like gonococcal instead of the usual step septic arthritis. So can we consider such diagnosis in a 12 years old boy, doctor?
Apa? What bacteria? Gonococcal. Eh?
Gonococcal, yes, from STD and such. I mean like.
Yeah, possible. We apa always possible in the beginning of the history kan with you get chief complaint, yeah, possible. You should apa namanya ask further lah. Whether the patient's apa namanya apa nama dia maturity dia dah mature ke dah menstrual ke and then ya sexual dia punya behavior possible je in kalau ada apa kita sebut ya STD in this apa namanya period of age. Tapi tanya dulu lah, ada istri dia tak ada lah, I think kan.
Tak ada.
Nah. Okay, so other infection ini ada kat sini. Ini siwa ada siapa? Anis, Anis. Apa ni kat sini? Aklan dah tu apa? Try to roll out apa kat sini tadi? Dah sebut dia.
Active arthritis.
Huh? Apa?
And also
active
arthritis.
Sama tadi septic active arthritis yang lain apa lagi?
In the systemic review, he also want to roll out leptospirosis.
Okay, leptospirosis.
Because he asked about the jaundice.
Yes.
And the tracking.
Yeah, so leptospirosis one of the differential elements of fever with joint pain. Classic findings kalau leptospirosis kat mana? Pain dia, Anis, ingat tak?
Calf
pain. So siapa Aklan?
Patient have no such history, calf pain, lumbar pain, no conjunctival solution and no jaundice.
Okay, alright. Oh ada kat sini dah, tak nampak tadi. Alright. Okay, yang lain ada anything else you nak discuss pasal differential, nak fikirkan apa lagi? Infection, autoimmune.
Doctor, what about HSP, doctor? Can we consider such?
HSP lah, the P though should be there lah. Kalau we diagnose HSP, the purpura should be there. Kalau no purpura, we don't diagnose HSP. Possible memang ada case-case HSP masa first one, day one or day two belum keluar purpura kan. Ada pain dulu, tak apalah. We don't diagnose SSP at that time. We just diagnose as arthritis or arthralgia to roll out causes kan. But once the purpura is there, baru lagi we put SSP as differential. If no purpura, we don't put as differential. Because the name is very clear kan. SSP is straightforward diagnosis. Must have purpura.
Sorry, Dr. I would like to ask, in this case, because the fever is more than 5 days, but there is no criteria of like for the Kawasaki, which is like you need 4 out of 5 of the claim. Do we still need to consider because
Kawasaki? Okay, Kawasaki. Aklan nak jawab dulu tak?
Kawasaki. Yeah, I forgot to rule out from the relevant negative. So the bilateral non-purulent conjunctivitis anterior adenopathy and the strawberry tongue.
There is for the criteria of diagnosis the cream tu. Any yang positif ke tak? No one kan I think.
Only the fever doctor.
So even the creator of diagnosis is not fulfilled. Siapa? Jazri. the cream to no conjunctivitis, rash, edema, limfadenopathy, mucosal changes, tak ada semua. Ya memang iklan itu add on satu lagi lah, apa, no mucosal changes to strawberry tongue atau erythema hands and feet, tak ada. Okay, itulah apa, so this patient not fulfill criteria of Kawasaki, so we need to abolish lah. Masa on presentation memang boleh kita pikirkan, oh, maybe Kawasaki ke, but after the data, after we get the history and PE itu, we should rule out lah, it is not Kawasaki. One apa answer. The second answer, the age. Nah, so Kawasaki itu the predilection nggak mana? When usually the Kawasaki develop? At what age?
Less than 5?
Less than 5 years. Usually young age lah. Infant pun banyak. Infant 1-2 years old tu. Kalau more than 5 year old, still lah memang possible. Tak apalah. Apa, kita pikirkan tapi very rare lah, unlikely. Apalagi 12 year old ni. So, itulah pada saya nak apa? Cut off. Ingat cepat cardio disease ni yang acquired heart disease tu, kalau less than 5 pikirkan Kawasaki, kalau more than 5 pikirkan acute rheumatic fever. Nah, so biasa will not apa nama overlap lah this kind of disease tu. Ini yang child dia Kawasaki, jadi so kalau more than 5 years ya rheumatic fever. So. Okay.
I would like to ask something.
Yes.
For example, in this case, patient has fever for 12 days, quite a long time, and also joint pain. Can we or should we consider diagnosis such as malignancy, for example, leukemia? Because in leukemia, patient also present fever, and sometimes have joint pain too.
Can, boleh. Always put malignancy lah. It's common lah. Apa? Non-apanya specific. Presentation of malignancy kan, kalau spesifik kan we expect patient with pale or abdominal distension with apa hepatosplenomegaly or with lymphadenopathy kan, but sometimes yeah, many lah, not sometimes, it's common lah, it is non specific presentation, sometimes prolonged fever, so that's why one of the investigation apa, nah antara apa gila, simple je. Initial investigation to rule out malignancy. Count is routine lah.
And peripheral blood film.
Picture lah. The
initial.
Terus in pediatric malignancy kan most common is leukemia and acute kan, and lymphoblast lah, ALL. So simple just an FBP, full blood picture. You nak request PBF ke FBP? Nampak sama kan? Peripheral blood film ke full blood picture? Apa beza? Actually not much different. Even the technique pun sama. But usually kan our way of thinking tu kalau picture tu adalah nak tengok the apa namanya morphology of the blood cells tu untuk cari malignansi ke thalassemia ke. Kalau film tu actually more specific kalau kita minta apa but film for malaria. So, kalau PBF tu maknanya kita nak minta orang lab tu nak tengok di apa plasmodium for the thin film and kita hantar juga thick film juga. Kita minta dia buat thick film juga. Thin and thick film, yang thin untuk cari plasmodium, yang thick macam mana? Kalau yang thick plasmodium ya.
Quantitative or qualitative, thick or thin.
Nah, itulah yang thick rasa tengok plasmodium, yang thin tengok the erythrocyte kan. Kalau tak silap atau terbalik, itulah. Kalau film tu, the connotation for PBF is to look for malaria. Boleh je, actually this case juga kita minta PBF juga, one of the differential malaria juga. Usually malaria, apa yang you expect? Fever, the classic type of the fever is relapsing atau intermittent tu dia. Dia ada apa specific period every 3 days or every 4 days for quartana. Ada Aklan dia hantar apa FPP?
Ah, dalam kes ni tak buat dia tu.
Tak buat, tapi lah boleh je kita tengok dulu from the MBC tu kalau dia nampak anemia or trom and or thrombocytopenia and or leko tu boleh leukopenia boleh leukocytosis ya. The presentation of leukemia ni yang acute ni dia boleh pancytopenia, boleh bicytopenia with leukocytosis. Saya tengok the on which phase lah. Pancytopenia kalau dia masa apa namanya acute suppression dia rendah semua, very low semua. Tapi kalau dah the malignant cell dah banyak, blast cell dah banyak, jadilah bicytopenia, anemia and thrombocytopenia with leukocytosis and then keluar blast cell banyak. Sometimes hyperleukocytosis. Apa hyperleukocytosis? Akilah.
Presence of white blood cell more than 100.
Okay. Understandable. Alright. Alright, so anything else nak fikir about differentials? Okay lah, so kita fikir lagi apa, ikut through that first lah. Okay, Aklan, you may proceed. Maybe yang other part of history, yang pediatric history kan unremarkable kan? Ke ada anything else?
Remarkable lah tu. Semua yang lain unremarkable.
Okay. Vaksin. You nak discuss satu-satu tak? Tak yalah. You dah pandai kan year 5. Kalau year 3, every part ni, every session saya discuss satu-satu. Jadi orang tak faham lagi. Year 5 kena faham ya dah ya. Vaccination. You at least you kena faham di dari KKM punya apa namanya. Punya schedule. Apa step by step vaksin tu. And then apa tu growth, apa tu development. Untuk tahu growth ya, diet, nutrition dia macam mana. Okay ya, growth okay ya.
Okay.
Dah 12 tahun pun dah besar. Development, okay. Family shouldn't be any, apa namanya. Actually, tapi you tanya apa actually family?
Family history of connective tissue disease in specifically the SLE.
Yeah. Alright. And actually kalau rheumatic fever tu ada some genetic predisposition kan, tapi itulah genetic predisposition tu is not specific ada family history. Ya, yang penting ya from our race lah. Race ke mana? Mediterranean is Mediterranean. Senang je kena rheumatic. Okay, alright. Next.
What about the socioeconomic status as in like the
tax yang ni penting. That
it's low risk factor.
Yes, usually low economic status kan. Ini kan from kampung kan, from rural area. Eh? Even if you see, if you are in UM or UKM, you will very rarely see apa case of rheumatic fever in KL, Selangor, the urban area kan. Usually from rural area. Kalau in USM, UAE ini kan masih banyak from Maran, Rompin, mana Muazzam, case-case rheumatic fever masih banyak. Kua musang atau usually low economic and poor hygiene lah. Because ya ada data tu this apa post streptococcal infection kan. Kalau in rural in urban area tu even though masih ada possible kena streptococcus, but usually kan access to apa medical facilities, healthcare facilities is very easy kan. Senang je demam apa batuk sikit dah pergi KK ke, pergi klinik ke untuk minta obat. And then usually kan antibiotic treatment is overuse and in apa, especially in urban area. Kalau in rural ni sometimes ya demam sakit ya masih kat rumah. Tak dapat antibiotic lagi.
Dr. Can I ask, usually yes. When patient have history like of poor hygiene, in what sense do they have, like they don't brush their teeth ke or they don't wear shoes ke macam mana?
Sorry?
Poor hygiene. Usually when patient have like poor hygiene that can cause the ARF or osteoarthritis, usually what's like example the history?
Yeah, sure, it's fine. Apa? Apa namanya? Poor skin, apa namanya ni? Yeah, skin hygiene especially kalau yang septic arthritis tadi. Ya, yeah, boleh dia usually apa ya not clean skin lah, dia kulit dia banyak luka-luka, many apa scars. Oh yeah, satu yang balik rheumatic fever ni kan. So you kena get clear history of apa tadi? Previous septococcal infection kan? Apa history tadi, Aklan?
Patient, this one only pneumonia, but it was 3 years ago. Otherwise, the previous URTI patient and the guardians did not reported of any sore throats or any cough prior to this current presentation.
Jadi just concurrent fever with joint pain terus ya. Bukan demam datang dulu yang maybe last week ke?
No. Based on the history, patient did not recall of any previous fevers or any sore throats before.
Okay, yeah. So we go to the septococcal infection, post septococcal infection. Right? Usually, there are two major strain kan, rheumatogenic or nephritogenic kan. So kalau yang rheumatogenic ni, usually always come from tonsil, ya, tonsillitis. So in your PE, ada tak?
The tonsil was not inflamed and there was no exudates overlying the tonsils.
Undiagnosed pula yang ni. Usually tu lah kalau rheumatogenic yang kena ke jantung ni, usually dia from tonsil. But kalau yang nephritogenic can be from both lah. Can be from tonsillitis or
skin
infection, ya. Yeah. Ya, tadi contoh tadi yang jadi ditanya, kalau memang poor skin hygiene dia banyak scar, ada furuncle, ada cellulitis, boleh jadi AGN. Ya. And then the timing juga, usually yang rheumatogenic dia much shorter than nephritogenic. Kalau yang nephritogenic, maybe yang skin tu dia boleh 3-4 weeks or more, ya, chronic. Kalau yang tonsillitis ni, rheumatogenic sometimes ya cepat. In theory 1-2 weeks, tapi ada je kita, we got cases 3 days demam sakit tekak and then develop rheumatic fever 3-5 days. Atau macam ni kan maybe ya concomitant, tapi kan kalau in current situation dia dah tak ada tonsillitis, dah tak jumpa. Ya. The tonsillitis itself already resolved kan. Tengok di tonsil already no findings. So sometimes ya cepatnya di tonsillitis ya one shot and then without antibiotic and then with poor hygiene dia cepatnya terus circulating antigen with MHC yang susceptibility yang di R4, di R8 saya lupa. So akan develop apa pathophysiology dia, Aglan?
Molecular mimicry towards the M protein elaborated by the group A streptococcus. So it will attack the for example the carditis, it can involve the endocarditis, which is the valve, the myocarditis and also epicarditis. And the side of mycorrhiza is really it attacks the lysoganglocytes within the basal ganglia, hence the choreotic movement of the patients.
Apa yang attack tu? Yang menyerang
apa? Antibody against that we mounted the antibody response against the protein, yeah. But molecular mimicry occur.
Usually immune complex ya, yeah, the antibody and complement. So not the antigen itself ya, yeah? Not the streptococcus bacteria. So the streptococcus only induce the antibody, and then antibody due to the hypersensitivity dia develop immune complex antigen antibody complex with apa complement tu. This one yang in hypersensitivity individu dia akan attack the cells of the host, yang mikri tadi. So usually dia circulating antibody yang type 3, usually hypersensitivity dia. Okay. So inilah the mimicry itu yang banyak lah, di can be in the endocard, myocard and valve lah, yang di heart, and then as well as attack the joint. apa lagi tadi, the skin pun dah jadi erythematous, jadi erythema marginatum, and then the subcutaneous jadi nodule. Lagi satu apa ni, korea ya, korea tu attack ke mana ni,
basal ganglia tu dia.
So inflammation of the basal ganglia tu jadi. Alright. So, alright. Proceed.
Okay. 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 Okay.
Okay. Okay.
Doctor, do we need to actually monitor patient if there is any kidney involvement as well in this patient, even though there is a different strain of the infection, right?
Then, I got case lah, memang kena dua-dua dia. Kena rheumatic fever and IgN lah. But usually, we just simple from history je. Despite this apa, fever and apa namanya, joint pain. Does he have any apa, any hematuria or not? Ya? Hypertension pun usually simple kan, in PE kita ada cek lah. Ada dia, hypertension tak ada lah kan, BP Patterson normal ya.
Sama stable itu.
Okay, no hematuria kan. Sometimes if you get the patient with hypertension, you should check the urine lysis lah to rule out microscopic hematuria. But in this case, I don't think kan. No urine analysis done, man. It's okay. At least clinically dulu, but if with hypertension, we should think about the IgN. Mana?
Doctor, I have one more question. Sorry, Doctor, I have one more question.
Yes.
Regarding the point migratory polyarthritis, to say that it is migratory polyarthritis, should it be like the pain in one joint resolved and then the pain in another joint started, or can it be concurrent?
Aklan, jawab.
In the textbook, doesn't specify as to require resolution of one joint to proceed with another. As with this case, some of them occur concurrent and some of them like resolute, then another one will come.
Ya, yeah. Apa cannot be specific lah. Cannot be satu habis dulu baru yang lain tak. Can anything can lah. Boleh je satu-satu, boleh je sama-sama. Based on experience, memang both are possible. Yang penting kan the process tadi, you paham, you understand the inflammatory reaction tadi. Can attack many joints together, can attack satu-satu, and this the apa depend on the circulating antibody tadi.
Doctor.
Yes.
Can I ask about the in order to diagnose the rheumatic fever, we need to fulfill the Jones criteria and also history apa evidence of previous infection. But is there any condition where the title tu is not raised? Is it compulsory for the title to be raised?
Yes. Oh, Aklan, jawab tak?
Nelson mentioned that there are three ways for us to demonstrate the antecedent septococcal infection. First is based on the throat swab and culture. Second is based on the ASOT titer, the antibody titer. And the third one will be the rapid septococcal antigen test. However, the rapid septococcal antigen test, if based on I did not see it being done in our setting. Doctor, can you elaborate more on that?
Yes, we usually don't check lah the antigen streptococcus. We just check ASOT dengan culture, apa throat swab tu. Much more difficult lah to get positive apa result from the throat swab. The most sensitive memang ASOT kan. Once apa there is circulating antibody tadi, ASOT will be positive kan. And then it will remain positive for sampai until 6 months. So the easiest one, memang the easiest way, the most sensitive, yaitu check ASOT tadi. So because it is most sensitive, kalau ASOT negatif, unlikely lah dia apa namanya positive to cold infection. Jadi kalau positive to cold infection, ya kita akan dapatkan tuh ASOT positif. Kalau yang swab culture kan lagi susah ya, tadi kan negatif nanti this case. So based on the criteria tu memang kena ada lah, with evidence. Maksudnya ada evidence tu, bukan hanya agak-agak, bukan hanya suspicion ya. With evidence maknanya memang kena positif, either the swab or apa SOT or tadi antigen. Tapi kan ya, the most sensitive the easiest way to check SOT.
Thank you.
Alright. Okay, proceed. Okay, Agulan, anything else? Kita tengok PE.
So for the social,
dia memang dari, kita tengok sekejap lah. Socialist tadi memang dia poor hygiene kan, from rural kan ya? Ya poor apa, low economic. Low economic status. Okay, alright.
However, I did not inquire about the hygiene specifically in this patient.
Boleh tanya je. The skin, apa namanya, tak ada kat sini. PE ni.
There is no skin rashes or any skin infection is actually not stated in this case set up. Patient was examined on day 5 of admission. So patient was conscious, alert, no jaundice, no pills, not cyanotic. There is no noticeable lymphadenopathies and examination of throats reveals non-inflamed, and there is no exudative over the tonsils. The JVP was not elevated, and no sacral or ankle edema that might suggest a heart failure, which is the complications of ARF. There is also no presence of any malar rash, no alopecia that might suggest SLE, no blanching purpura rashes as we can see in HSP, and there is no bodily rashes characteristics of dengue or any erythema marginatum as what we can see in acute rheumatic fever. So the vital signs are all stable. Whereas the anthropometric measures is as stated 140 centimeters between 10 to 25 centiles, weight 53 kilograms on the 90.
Apa ni your comment ni? Your comment training.
This patient is overweight, doctor. 25.20.
Overweight lah. Dia clinically on your general examination pun, you kena aku big comment kan, dia nampak look overweight kan.
Oh, okay. Proceeding with cardiovascular examinations, there is no presence of any signs that suggest mitral regurg or aortic regurgitations, and there is no heart failure signs such as Gallop rhythms or any cardiomegalies. All other examinations are unremarkable. For respiratory examinations, there is no signs that might suggest acute heart failure such as bilateral spine crepitations. And rheumatologic examinations during the day of clerking, only the left knee was noticed to be swollen with some tenderness and limited range of motions due to pain. However, all the other joints are unremarkable as what is being stated in the history previously. Neurological examination, there is no abnormal movements aside from chorea, involuntary purposeless movements of the limbs as noted in the patient. Otherwise, all other systems are unremarkable.
Tadi yang CVS tadi tak ada murmur ya?
CVS, there was no murmur, doctor.
Okay, alright. Proceed, tak apa. Tadi tak baca ya.
So as a summary, so 12 years old Malay boys with no antecedent URTI and no underlying autoimmune history, presented with histories of fevers and migrating spondy arthritis. No other major Jones criteria fulfilled. History is less suggestive of dengue, leptospirosis, septic arthritis, reactive arthritis, and patient is not in acute heart failures. On examinations, there is evidence of arthritis over the left knee. Otherwise, there is no similar evidence of arthritis elsewhere. And also, patients have no histories that might suggest rheumatic heart disease such as mitral valve, mitral regurgitations, aortic regurgitations, and patient is not in failures. There is also no evidence to suggest any pharyngitis from the clinical examinations. And patients have no findings to support other differentials as what stated previously.
That's it? Yeah, I wish.
This is the list of differentials.
Itulah tadi, the dengue itu shouldn't be there lah, but dah 12 hari. Alright, next kita dah discusskan. Okay, next.
So as for the investigation, so first and foremost, I would like to divide the investigations into bedsides, blood and imaging. As for the bedsides, with regards to this case, I would like to do bedsides ECG to look for PR prolongations or any higher degrees of heart blocks, which is one of the Jones minor criteria. So for this particular case, it was unremarkable. There is no PR prolongations or any AV blocks noticeable in this patient. Second is I would like to do throat swabs and cultures to check for antecedent streptococcal infections. However, the results yields negative growth. As for the blood investigations, rapid test should not be done because it should be not be in the differential because of the fever already long. But it was done and by the ED anyway. Second is the full blood count. So leukocytosis is one of the minus criteria for Jones. And also it can rule out infectious causes such as septic arthritis. Anemia can also be seen in SLE. And as doctor mentioned just now, in considerations of acute malignancy of the lymphoids or the myeloid series, so we can expect either cytopenic or leukocytosis. So this is the results for this with regards to this patient. So actually, the hemoglobin is normal. Only the abnormalities lies at the platelet, which was it is actually high at 695. However, I cannot find any possible explanations pertaining to this.
Simple je. Kalau nak fikir Kawasaki tadi kan, siapa? Jazzy dah tanya kan. Yang kita fikir selalunya kalau thrombocytosis kan Kawasaki, but in this is unlikely ya. Actually simple je. Any infection cases, we can kalau viral kan sometimes thrombocytopenia kan, especially dengue. But in other bacterial infection, actually one of the common finding is reactive thrombocytosis. So, kalau ada bacterial infection tuh sometimes ya platelet akan increase. So it is this condition we call it reactive thrombocytosis memang. Part of the bone marrow reaction against the infection tuh despite increasing the white cells ya platelet boleh naik juga. This one bone marrow reaction of the infection, especially bacteria.
ESR was also done as part of the workup for acute dermatic fevers. So the results revealed to be more than 120 millimeters per hour. So it is elevated, indicative of inflammation, and fulfilled the Jones minor criteria. So ASOT titers were also done to look for antecedent streptococcal infections, and the result yield to be positive at 1,600 international units per milliliters. So as for the imaging as part of the investigations, I would like to do chest X-ray to look for the complications of acute rheumatic fevers in which patients can present with acute heart failures. So I would like to expect acute pulmonary edemas as part of the presentation. However, in this case, it was unremarkable. Echocardiography is also another modality for imaging. So I would like to look for evidence of endocarditis, pathological mitral regurgitations, aortic regurgitations, and some structural changes of mitral valve and aortic valve. For example, the thickening of the leaflet, the thickening of the cordae tendineae, and also the restricted leaflet motions. However, in the case setup, it does not specify, only mention that only the mild mitral regurgitations. However, there is no specifications of the jet velocity or the jet length, and also the leaflet description.
Yes, okay. So it can be actually mild, trivial or mild MRT can be normal findings in every echo. But can be also some part of the rheumatic heart disease. Nah. So in this case, tak apalah kita just we can consider as rheumatic heart disease lah in this patient. Tak apa, kita ambil je.
Doktor, kiranya ini dah kira another major criteria. Is it, Doktor?
Yes, boleh.
Okay, thank
Even though clinically kan no chest pain, no palpitation, no prolong ECG pun normal, echo normal, boleh je kita ambil mild MRE as one of the major criteria. But usually kalau yang ada MRE, usually with cardiomegaly lah. Patient ni kan cardiomegaly tak ada. Actually maybe normal lah, but okay lah, we can also consider one of the major criteria arthritis ni. So it depends lah. Karena tak clear apa, tadi tak all data tu tak complete kan.
Doktor.
Yes.
So echocardiography is actually compulsory lah to be done in PRF patient.
Yes. Sama macam Kawasaki kan, we need echo, but different kan kalau dah Kawasaki dah established, we just give FAIG echo to apa to find any apa namanya coronary artery dilatation. Nah, tapi kalau incomplete Kawasaki, maybe we need echo dululah tu. Kalau tak sure ni betul Kawasaki ke tak, kita buat echo dulu untuk oh, kalau nak jumpa coronary artery dilatation, okay lah, kita confirm Kawasaki. Kalau for apa namanya for rheumatic fever and to get any cardiitis or not, yeah, we confirm with echo lah. Clinically memang in this patient kan tak ada, tak nampak. Tapi echo ni itulah. MR ni can be normal, ya can be cardiitis. Betul, usually kalau cardiitis with MR ni usually ya should be cardiomegaly, should be there. No, sure lah. Maybe for me, I will not consider as cardiitis dulu lah, because no cardiomegaly kan. Eh, boleh je kalau we want to be over diagnosis, so just consider as cardiitis. Because the management will different nanti. So lepasnya we discuss management kan. Alright. That's it.
So as for the management, so first and foremost, we need to resuscitate the patients, secure the airway, breathing circulations, disabilities and exposures. And specifically for treatments of acute rheumatic fever, so we must consider antibiotics. So it has two roles, either the primary prevention or the secondary prevention. So as for the primary prevention, as I mentioned before that, it requires the antecedent streptococcal infections to occur so that it can cause the molecular
okay. Jajak dulu. Tadi yang non-specific kan ABC ya biasa. Lagi satu actually the important part, ya kena bed rest lah. Kena hospitalized for bed rest. So itu buat part of the non-specific management lah. Okay, bed rest ditulis, and then for specific, yeah. So we discuss first is antibiotic. Okay, proceed.
So antibiotic, so it has either the primary prophylaxis or secondary prophylaxis. So for the primary prophylaxis is to be given at the initial primary care. So it's actually there's a scoring system device in order for us to certify when we want to take the cultures and when we want to take the antibiotic, in which we've all learned in family medicine posting, where it is known as the MAC-ISAAC score. So MAC-ISAAC score has a few parameters. So the total score of 2 or more, we need to take the cultures. If it is positive, we are to give the antibiotic. If it is 4 or more, we give the antibiotic regardless of the results of the culture. So the parameters covered in MAC-ISAAC score would be the fevers more than 38 degrees Celsius and tender anterior cervical nodes, exudative and inflamed throat tonsils. Another one would be the lack of cough, and also the age group, 3 to 14 years. So we calculate total all of this, so we can decide whether to give or not give. And then because these patients already have those disease, so we can give secondary prophylaxis. So we give the IV penicillin, 50,000 units per kg, or we can give per oral penicillin V based on the patient's weight. We need to give 250 or 500 mg for a total period of 10 days duration. It is to be given 6 hourly. And then secondary prophylaxis, it depends on whether the patients have carditis and whether the patients have residual heart disease or not. So the tables taken below is actually a script from National Antibiotic Guideline. So rheumatic fevers with no carditis, we start with the most bottom one, 5 years after diagnosis or 21 years of age, whichever is longer. And then rheumatic fever with carditis but no valvular heart disease, 10 years after diagnosis or 21 years, whichever is longer. And for those with residual valvular disease, textbook mentioned lifelong, but in the National Antibiotic Guideline mentioned that 10 years or 40 years, 10 years after diagnosis or 40 years of age, whichever is longer. And then what is to be given is the per oral penicillin V or IM benzatine penicillin given as secondary prophylaxis. So second part of outlines of all management.
Right. We'll discuss one by one. Yeah? Antibiotic first. Yeah? All right. So for MAC-ISAAC score, it's not apa namanya kriteria to start antibiotic in rheumatic fever ya. So make SX corny is criteria to give or not to give antibiotic in streptococcal infection, in tonsillitis or pharyngitis. So kalau you have patient with sore throat or demam sesemua kan, so nak bagi antibiotic ke tak, you use make SX score. Usually the prevalence of streptococcal tonsillitis ni only 15% lah compared to other apa namanya viral or non-specific causes of the pharyngitis. So kalau apa? So normally kan, so that's why kan in normal pharyngitis in early phase of pharyngitis we don't give antibiotic unless if make SX score positive we must give antibiotic. Okay, but if rheumatic fever diagnosis is already established, so the antibiotic apa namanya primary prophylaxis ini must be there. We must start with this apa PNV for 10 days and then followed by secondary prophylaxis. Nah, itu ya. So bukan kalau make SX score negatif you tak payah bagi PNV for 10 days, no. In all case of rheumatic fever, regardless patient still even the patient dah tak demam pun, we always give with apa namanya 10 days course of the penicillin because we need eradication first. Yang 10 days course of antibiotic ini kita sebut eradication. Eradication itu regardless the patient still fever ke tak ada apa demam ke, pasalnya kan macam tadi kan when you check the pharynx already clear, but we must start with eradication first. We must eradicate the antigen is the focus. Even though tak nampak, maybe the antigen is still there in apa in circulation. So we must give 10 days antibiotic to eradicate the streptococcus. And then after that, baru followed by secondary prophylaxis to prevent reinfection.
Doctor, is there any reason as to why we want to choose penicillin V per oral or IV C pen, doctor?
Yeah, depend on the usually kan it will be kalau rheumatic fever will be in hospital setting kan, inpatient management kan. Because tadi kan tadi yang first role tadi in non-specific ya, we admit patient for bed rest kan, rehat dulu. So because we admit inpatient bed rest, usually we have IV line kan. Kalau ada IV line ya lagi senang lah, IV access should be more effective kan than per oral. Unless kalau we don't have IV access or patient very stable, betul-betul tak nak admit, usually we give oral. But sometimes itu another setting macam tu je. Biasa kan masa admit demam baru sehari demam dah hilang, patient dah minta balik kan. Nah, itulah we usually change to oral lah. Patient sometimes ya kalau patient dah very stable, no cardiitis, no cardiomegaly, no heart failure, we can discharge patient early. We can discharge with oral penicillin sampai complete 10 days. Yeah.
Alright. Okay. For the IV C-pen, yeah, do we need to give for 10 days for the eradications also?
Oral. So that's why then the principle, as long as you give 10 days course of antibiotic for eradication. Kalau in patient kan kita bagi IV, kalau patient discharge ya tukar oral. Boleh je. So no issue lah. Yes?
Do we need to start the antibiotic straight away even though, or do we need to wait for the actually the investigation for confirm the ERF?
Yes lah kan, because you confirm the rheumatic fever tadi dah ada SOT tu baru we confirm. But usually lah memang apa? Kalau in our hospital management tu, even before we get the result, kalau clinically very suggestive, ya we start the antibiotic, no issue. But masa in admission when we start antibiotic kan kita tak declare lagi nak start apa eradication for 10 days. Maybe ya give antibiotic for 10 apa for no any non-specific bacterial infection kan. But once established the diagnosis, ya we must do for 10 days. Antibiotik.
continue je lah kan maksudnya doktor. Maksudnya kita dah start, kita dah start antibiotic earlier for the non-specific causes and then we continue je lah.
Continue lah 10 days antibiotic. Boleh lah kalau dah patient dah minta balik, tukar orang. Actually ada lagi addition ya, kalau in case biasa kan common case is allergic to penicillin kan. So we go for erythromycin. Sama lah in eradication atau in secondary prophylaxis. Kalau alergi apa penicillin, secondary prophylaxis ya tukar erythromycin.
From the pathogenesis earlier, we discussed that the development of acute rheumatic fever is actually because of the molecular mimicry which causes deposition of immune complex. So it is an after effect of after infection. But still we are giving patients antibiotic. That means that at the point of time where patient has ARF, there is still some sort of infection ke, doctor?
Yes, still possible. So that's why kan the guideline tu memang still need to eradicate. Because it is still possible, the antigen is still there. The one we check kan, apa nama tadi, SOT kan, the antibody. Even though apa, kita sebut post-tetococcal infection, but it is possible, or most possible. What more kalau still ada demam ni, ada rheumatic fever, ada apa, fever. So, apa, we must do the eradication because the antigen still possible still there. Then if we skip tadi, kalau kata MSX score negatif, kita tak bagi 10 days course ni. So apa jadi? So the antigen still there, the infection still there, the inflammatory reaction tak akan habis, the antibody will still produce bila nak baik. So the protocol to resolve to improve or the management guideline to apa to eradicate the sepokus ya bagi antibiotic dan dish. Because sometimes pun ada some in severe condition ada patient until 7-8 days pun still fever ya. We may prolong not only 10 days sometimes until 2 weeks until 14 days the antibiotic. Sometimes we increase juga, we step up to second line of antibiotic. Ada case-case itulah. After 2-3 days antibiotic, after 4-5 dose, after the penicillin dah reach di therapeutic range, still apa nampak dia tak improve, maybe we can go to second line. Second line ya kamu lah, cephalosporin. Okay. Alright. So yang and then secondary prophylaxis duration ini yang penting ya. So belum selesai yang ini. The table ini penting ya. Key point in management of rheumatic fever ini yaitu secondary you must classify in every single step tadi classify. Ini sekarang antibiotik ya secondary prophylaxis you must classify. Yeah, without carditis, with carditis. Ada yang carditis with apa cardiomegaly, ada carditis with heart failure juga. Yang patient ini maybe we just simply use them because unlikely dia tak ada cardiomegaly kan, unlikely lah yang MRT tadi significant lah. So I will choose yang the row ni yang without carditis. So he need prophylaxis at least for 5 years and or until 20 year old. Okay. Kalau let's say ada carditis, ada chest pain, ada apa cardiomegaly. So 10 years. But if with valvular heart disease, the one that further kita sebut rheumatic heart disease, chronic rheumatic heart disease ya. So we usually apa will refer the patient to adult cardiologist lah. We give antibiotic prophylaxis sampai umur 18 or 21 year old and then we refer to cardiologist lah. Adult cardiologist to continue the prophylaxis. Usually after 21 years, apa cardiologist will apa will adult cardiologist will take over na. Sampai 40 actually a long life lah usually.
Doctor.
Yes.
I would like to ask, actually there if there is any reason behind actually why we give prophylaxis up to 21 year old.
And this one evidence lah from the previous study. Yeah? If we do apa nama, if we give very short, for example, or without prophylaxis, apa jadi? Yeah, possible reinfection kan? Because this individual kan is susceptible individual. He has or apa all the patient has susceptibility. Dia ada MHC specific MHC class 2 yang type 4 or 8 tu. Whenever dia get this septal infection, this will happen again. So banyak study dah buat macam tu lah. Kalau rheumatic fever dia very easy to develop recurrency or relapse or reinfection. Ya. Karena dah ada susceptibility tu. Kalau kena kuman lagi, so will develop relapse another apa acute rheumatic fever. So kalau berkali-kali kena, ya. So of course kan the effect ya. Very apa very fatal kan will develop apa rheumatic heart disease later. Apalagi kalau dah ada rheumatic heart disease ni, if we don't give prophylaxis, so if later develop another septal infection, the valvular heart disease will worsen, jadi buruk lagi fail lah nanti apa di lagi worse di MR ke AR ke. Heart failure worse, a patient will not survive. So we must protect the patient from another apa septal infection. How long to protect? The duration that already established. It is from the established study before lah. Research, meta analysis sampai systematic review.
But doctor, this is only applicable for the ARF lah kan doctor, rheumatic fever, yes. Not the other streptococcal infection.
Yes, because tadi yang strain of rheumatogenic, kalau individu yang susceptible ni, kalau kena strain rheumatogenic jadi rheumatic fever. But different with yang nephritogenic, kalau AGN, acute glomerulonephritis, dia good prognosis and no need secondary prophylaxis after we eradicate for 10 days tadi kalau AGN ya unlikely develop relapse or infection or apa recurrent. Why? Ya still apa not clear, actually not clear apa namanya data, but usually kalau we just think logically kalau AGN ni usually ya di antibody towards streptococcus tu will persist lah. Yang nephritogenic strain tu will not re-attack the patient. Dia very unlikely akan develop recurrent AGN. Because 95% lah good prognosis lah AGN. Kalau rheumatic fever tu lah, because so many cases of reinfection, relapse, so we must go for secondary prophylaxis. Okay, ya, duration dah paham ni, so you kena ada ikut this three criteria ni. Next.
Doctor, I would like to ask about the secondary prophylaxis because it must be given about macam it's a long time. So is there any follow up to check the compliance of the patient to prevent the prophylaxis?
Of course lah. So once we have patient with rheumatic fever, we must apa very strict to give apa education to the patient. Memang betul kena duduk patient. Even though ada je saya ada sekarang ada one patient in under my follow up tu. Actually ya high economic status juga. Kayaknya tapi it's still possible. So we must apa explain educate early ya siap-siap. Ini sekarang ya. Apa ke luckily my patient tu only yang samalah without carditis lah. so kena 5 tahun kena explain in detail, make sure at least apa 5 years 5 years without apa namanya without another infection. So how to get apa how to prevent another infection? We must give apa nama prophylaxis antibiotic. If what happen we don't give, if we don't give, saya kena explain in detail. If we don't give, what happen? Ya recurrence, recurrent another infection apa jadi? Ya we usually give apa namanya worrying situation to the parents lah. So kita takut-takutkan patient lah. Kalau kena balik jantung nanti bocor, jadi bukan bocor lah. Apa katup rosak. Macam ni, so cakap macam tu. Usually patient will be afraid lah. Kalau kita takutkan dia apa katup rosak nanti jantung bengkak, kena operate ke, kena makan obat jantung long life, lagi more fatal kan. So to prevent simple je. Kalau macam ni 5 years je dulu. 5 years no recurrency, that's safe, insyaallah usually we can apa discharge after 5 years. Memang follow up memang panjang. Nah, usually kita tengok kalau oral yang my patient tu give oral ya can be every 3 months. Baik kalau yang apa IM injection atau 4 weekly atau ada in case kalau actually kalau yang with heart failure dia every 3 weeks ya. Kalau yang intramuscular injection yang long acting penicillin. Actually ya itulah can be ya it is yang ini patients and parents boleh pilih lah. So nak pilih cocok apa sebulan sekali atau nak makan obat tiap hari. So tengoklah yang usually kalau tak nak sakit ya makan obat tapi kena food compliance daily. BD lah, BD dose. But kalau patient nampak poor compliance susah nak makan obat ya memang kena paksa monthly injection. Kalau monthly injection kan tak payah makan obat. Dia datang je sebulan sekali tapi sakit lah sebulan sekali cocok. Kalau poor compliance ya kena itu that's why ada some like my supervisor in cardio tu dia galak lah sekarang patient takut ni. Alright.
Doctor, for the secondary prophylaxis, because the antibiotic is used for a long period, will there be a chance of development of antibiotic resistance, which causes to have to change another antibiotic?
Resistance usually we only apa namanya investigate if develop another cause lah. For example, already good compliance, already monthly injection, or only daily taking medication develop another apa namanya infection relapse. So we investigate lah possible resistance. If not, you just continue. You just give apa injection or daily apa oral antibiotic until stability time. Boleh 5 years or 10 years or long life.
Okay, I have a question. Yes. In textbook mentioned that recurrence is more common in adolescent and adult. May I ask kalau macam for the when we give the secondary prophylaxis and then another recurrence occur, do we need to reset the time frame for the secondary prophylaxis?
Okay. Yes lah. Yang after recurrence itu, for example second attack, yeah we to restart lah. We count from zero again. Yang dah, for example 3 tahun okay, and then sekarang kena balik, ya kita kira dari nol balik. Kita kira another 5 years lah, first for example ya. If without carditis, if with carditis, ya kena 10 years. If with heart failure, ya kena long life. With valvular, with chronic rheumatic heart. Okay. Alright, masih banyak lagi ni, Aklan. Next.
So the second outline of management will be to give NSAID and aspirin. So it is 2 treatments of the joint pain. And the textbook mentioned that characteristic of acute rheumatic fever, it will respond very well with NSAIDs administrations. And the third outlines would be anti-inflammatory agents. So we need to cover for carditis. So either we can opt for, depends on the patients, if patient have no or mild carditis, or it is severe carditis. If it is no or mild carditis, we can opt for aspirin, which is to be given in 100 mg per kg, 4 divided doses in 1 day, and then for to give for 4 weeks and tapered over a period of 4 weeks. And then if the patients have severe carditis, that we are opt to give per oral prednisone 2 mg/kg per day in 2 divided doses. And actually in Pitt's protocol mentioned 2 to 4 weeks, but in Nelson mentioned 2 to 3 weeks, then half for 2 to 3 weeks. And then we taper down by 50 mg per day for 2 to 3 days. And then during the tapering downs, we need to cover also with aspirin to prevent from rebounds, hypersensitivity reaction. And then actually the fourth outline I forgot to put here would be if the patient have heart failures, then we are to treat the acute heart failures with diuretics, ACE inhibitors, and also digoxin if necessary.
Okay, actually yang ni, slide ni kena one number je, bukan number two and three. Ya. Macam tadi kan, number one antibiotik, yang secondary prophylaxis, you have three, apa namanya tadi? Three groups tadi kan? Mm-hmm. Yang without carditis, number two is carditis only, yang number three with chronic rheumatic heart, yang valvular. So yang number ni, number second ni, actually the topic is anti-inflammation, ya, anti-inflammatory. It's also three kan. Yang first is without carditis only aspirin. Ya. Number two with carditis, yang mal carditis ni maknanya tak ada valvular heart disease kan, tak ada heart failure. So you bagi this one aspirin for 4 weeks. Ya. Betul ya?
This is born from Pitt's protocol.
Yes, itulah. Kalau yang tadi yang without carditis, aspirin tu ya to only to treat apa namanya yang number two ni yang first without carditis, aspirin only to treat the pain ya. After pain resolve, we stop. Number two ni kalau with carditis sama carditis must four weeks ya. Biasanya ada carditis kena 4 minggu bagi aspirin. Okay, yang last number three. Third group, kalau with heart failure, with valvular heart disease, we must give prednisolone for 2 weeks and then taper down for another 2 weeks. And then yang week 3, add on with aspirin. Yeah. Aspirin itu ya 2 weeks juga. So itulah, ini jadi satu. Ini bukan number 2 and number 3. Yeah. Ini one group of management. Yeah.
Yeah, I will add it later on.
Yes. Alright, and then next, next tu baru heart failure lah. Kalau patient with heart failure, adalah tadi ya. Kalau with heart failure, despite this giving anti-inflammatory, give steroid, ya, yeah, you must give anti-failure. Anti-failure ya sama lah. Usually we simple apa namanya? We have three kan, three ways to give anti-failure to either reduce preload, reduce afterload, tengah-tengah lah ya, reduce preload, and then improve the contractility, the heart itself, and then last kali, reduce afterload. So yang reduce preload tuh ya diuretic lah, furosemide, or kalau na long term ya spironolactone. And then second is improve contractility, ya give digoxin. And then lastly, yang untuk reduce afterload, bagi apa?
ACE inhibitor.
So to reduce afterload. Usually, the strategy of the medication nak pilih mana dulu, itulah the simplest one, the kata reflex tu apa, spinal reflex. Kalau patient with heart failure, bagi diuretics-nya. So kalau you jadi doktor, ada heart failure, it is no harm you bagi diuretics, tak payah konsul dulu. Reflect lah itu, spinal reflect, tak payah pikir, memang tak payah pakai use your brain. Nampak je patient heart failure, bagi diuretics. Tak payah discuss, tak payah consult. Because it is no harm. Kalau you tak bagi, ya salah kan. You call the cardiologist, patient heart failure, you belum bagi diuretics, kena marah biasa. So bagi je dulu diuretics, baru pikir kemudian. So diuretics usually always be given, very apa namanya, freely lah, senang je bagi diuretics. And then usually kan kalau ini inpatient management setting kan ada IV line, ya senang je bagi furosemide. IV boleh, oral boleh. And then, but the effect apa? Side effect yang kena aware.
Hypokalemia due to the urine.
Yes, the potassium depletion. Yeah. Hypokalemia, dia excessive urine, jadi potassium habis. So, that's why masa start kita kena ada baseline potassium level. Selalunya patient admit pun dah ada kan apa electrolyte account apa result dia, BUSE dia. So tengok potassium berapa, and then we start. Start pun, we usually kalau we give furosemide, yeah, usually we need to check every 3 days at least, yeah? Seminggu 2 kali check, because it is potassium depletion. If the plan is to give long term, more than 3 days or more than 1 week, so we need to think kan, whether if we give furosemide, we must apa namanya give additional or supplementation of potassium, kena bagi apa namanya tabletnya lupa saya, itulah potassium tablet. Atau kalau patient still inpatient, yeah, you can give apa nama, you can give potassium correction ya, yeah, in IV fluid. Okay, but usually lah only we apa we think furosemide only for 3 days to 1 week. Kalau need more than that, apa yang kena pikir another apa namanya another simple guideline protocol, we combine kan, combine with apa,
spironolactone,
with spironolactone, because spironolactone effect is potassium sparing, yeah? So duo to diuretics. Tapi depend juga kalau patient preload dia tak tinggi sangat, dia patient dah nampak kurus tak bengkak ke, dan kalau takut dia apa namanya negatif balance dia teruk sangat, bagi duo ni lagi banyak diuretik kan, lagi habis ni dehydration kan, bahaya. So another option lagi satu is to combine with ACE inhibitor tadi. So boleh furosemide with apa namanya captopril tu. Captopril dia ada some effect of potassium sparing juga. So boleh je furosemide with captopril only ni, dua ni. So dia kita dapat dua-dua lah kan. Kita dapat to reduce preload and reduce afterload. Kalau potassium furosemide with spironolactone kan only reduce preload. So depend lah kita individual apa namanya the decision tu ya, individual case by case basis kan. Kalau patient ni nampak very dry, dehydration, better we combine with ACE inhibitor captopril. But kalau patient nampak dia hypotension, BP dia tak tinggi sangat, dan nampak apa-apa, nampak bengkak ke, nampak macam ni kan, this patient overweight kan, maybe still okay lah to give two diuretics. Dan baru lastly, when you need to give apa nama, yang ini boleh discuss lah with consult to cardiologist, nak combine with spironolactone ke, nak combine dengan apa nama captopril ke. Then lastly, yang when you need to give digoxin, ini yang very strict ya. Digoxin tu apa bahaya dia? Dia very narrow therapeutic windows, dia easily develop toxicity. Jadi bagi digoxin terlampau lebih, dia jadi toxic lah. Jadi apa namanya? Boleh jadi AF lah, bahaya. So when we need to give digoxin memang very strict, you must usually memang cardiologist lah yang apa need to start, because decision tu usually kalau Malaysian punya style ni usually AGN lah, orang AGN punya guideline tu only kalau ejection fraction on echo tu very low lah. Low tu ya less than 60%. Baru kita start digoxin. Kalau ejection fraction masa echo masih bagus 70 apalagi 80%, usually we don't start ada ejection. Sudah jarang sangat very rare you see patient-patient from IJN to on digoxin. Not liberal, apa namanya? It is not liberal management treatment. Kalau furosemide kan liberal, eh? You pick, tak payah fikir, jadi nampak heart failure, terus je bagi, nampak bengkak, bagi je furosemide. Sama ya, nampak pasien demam ya bagi paracetamol, ya? Jangan fikir. Regardless the causes, pasien bengkak ya bagi furosemide, pasien heart failure bagi furosemide. Sama pasien demam, apa-apa punca ya bagi obat demam lah. Kalau kita bagi obat demam, ya pasien seizure pula. Memang fibrillar seizure pula. Alright. Okay.
Let me ask.
Yes.
I read something about that in aspirin, we have to be cautious when giving to PIDS cases because of concern of Reye syndrome. So, is there any, like in clinically, do we have to see whether it is lesser or more than 3 years of age and then we give aspirin or?
Okay, so Reye syndrome itu related to tadi macam toxicity. Dia kalau above therapeutic range. So usually Reye syndrome itu actually develop kalau masa apa namanya dia accidentally dia makan for example PCM atau PCM satu botol atau itulah aspirin satu botol. Or kalau adult kan makan 10 or 100 more than 10 apa tablets lah. Actually kalau saya kira asal dia dose dia kena more than 100 mg per kg kan. So usually kan our therapeutic dose ya on only 10 to 15 mg per kg. So usually kan lah, kalau 10 times then the dose tu. For example dia actually the dose dia 5 mil dia ternyata makan 50 mil barulah risk of Reye syndrome satu. Nah, kalau therapeutic dose usually insyaallah safe lah. But ada ya possible tadi even the therapeutic dose ada some individu yang memang very sensitive dia develop Reye syndrome juga. So memanglah kita kena make sure the dose is adequate and not overdose ya. Kalau over only to full pun usually not lah. Okay. Memanglah nak monitor ya itulah ya tengoknya kalau dia asal makan dose betul therapeutic dose should be okay. And then ya itulah we monitor boleh je. Usually ada je kan baseline apa namanya OTNP PT itu AST and ALT itu level liver function test. So kalau nampak sometimes ya kalau nampak ada simptom lah simptom Reye syndrome apa ya biasalah hepatomegali dia nampak jaundice ke nampak not comfortable patient we need to check lah di apa AST and ALT will be apa at least threefold usually then tadi baseline kalau baseline for example AST 25 dia naik jadi 75 so naik nah apa increase threefold, tiga kali lipat. So, possibly ada early manifestation of Reye syndrome. Tapi lah very rare. And then lah kalau dah develop syndrome tu ya dah develop hepatomegali, develop jaundice. Simple aja kita tengok ya patient usually kan kalau you nampak dia makan obat sesuai dose, okay je lah kan dia. Just clinical monitoring pun sudah adequate. Tapi kalau nak add on with the laboratory monitoring, ya at least ada baseline AST ALT boleh je. Nak tengok, tadi kan the treatment of aspirin will be up to 4 weeks kan. Kalau nak tengok sekali dengan RFT, ya boleh kan. RFT kan kita kalau on furosemide, kita check every 3 days kan. Okay. Yes.
Nak confirmkan balik untuk anti-inflammatory therapy just now for severe carditis. So we start with prednisolone first for 4 weeks and then taper down for 2 weeks.
Bukan. 4 weeks prednisolone tu 2 weeks apa anti-inflammatory dose yang berapa tadi? And then another 2 weeks dia taper down. Masa taper down prednisolone tu we start
Aspirin.
Aspirin, yes.
Doctor, if the patient was discharged, we discharged from the hospital, so we give.
Yeah, TCA weekly lah usually.
TCA.
Tapi usually salah. Nanti actually another grouping tadi kan, first grouping profilaksis ada 3 grup tadi kan. Grouping anti-inflammatory pun ada 3 grup. Actually grouping bed rest pun sama 3 grup juga. How long we put patient on bed rest ya. Kalau patient tadi without carditis, nah itulah patient udah nampak okay, boleh aja discharge. Even antibiotic eradication pun boleh tukar oral kan. Boleh discharge. Tapi kalau group 2 patient with carditis, at least actually 2 weeks. Kalau patient dah ada kardiomegali ke, ada nampak MR ke, ada chest pain ke, actually kena duduk hospital 2 minggu actually. Nah itulah. So, and then what more yang group 3, kalau patient dah ada heart failure, actually patient must stay in hospital until heart failure resolve. Can be 4 weeks, can be more. Nah, itu so that's why masih on apa namanya heart failure itu on prednisolone. Actually patient kena in hospital lah, kena in patient masa 2 weeks prednisolone, even masa tapering down prednisolone and starting aspirin pun usually should be in patient. Tapi ada je sometimes memang case-case patient yang degil kan, dah tak nampak apa dyspneu, patient nak discharge juga even though belum 2 minggu, belum 4 minggu. Kalau in such case, okay lah, because the management can be oral kan. Patient on prednisolone 2 minggu, patient nak discharge, okay aja oral, ya kita buat weekly juga lah follow up sometimes. Ada yang case-case yang susah nak stay ke hospital. Tapi kalau that day kan, maybe bulan berapa? Last year I think, yang in STA itu, from Muazzam, memang dia stay few months lah, few weeks lah, sampai 6 weeks in the hospital.
Doctor, so the yes. Bed rest, it is for to prevent the acute heart failure, is it?
Yang for tadi yang kalau yang for apa namanya? Betul lah. For apa namanya? For yang without carditis ya, we just establish the eradication, make sure the apa namanya? The inflammation, the pain already resolved. Kalau yang with carditis, nah itu betul. Kalau misalnya with carditis sampai heart failure lah. So bed rest actually ideally 2 weeks kan tadi. Yang in group 2. Kalau in group 3 yang pasien dah in severe carditis, MR with heart failure. Actually kan dah heart failure kan. Your aim of bed rest for 4 weeks or more nih ya. Actually ya to resolve heart failure tadi, kita hilangkan dulu heart failure, barulah we can, and then apa tadi, including give prednisolone and aspirin tadi, resolve the inflammation, barulah we can discharge the patient after that.
Later, do yes. We need to repeat the ASOT or any throat swab to confirm the eradication?
Eradication ya tadi ya, kalau yang this case kan udah negatif ASOT ya tak payah negatif swab kan tak payah repeat tak apalah. For ASOT ingat tak apa kata saya, can remain persist until
six months.
Nah. Kalau so that's why after 10 days of eradication we don't check lah, we just proceed with secondary prophylaxis. Tapi memang betul, usually kalau nak check pun nanti check monthly. Because kalau if we check next month pun maybe still positive. 3 months pun maybe still positive. And then it is no point of will not change the management kan. We repeat next month or 2 months tu the management remain the same kan. So kalau you nak tahu we want to know betul hilang ke tak, ya usually at least paling cepat pun after 3 months lah. Usually every 6 months. Make sure tadi kan tadi yang positif for full tadi 1,600 maybe usually 3 months lah. 3 months from now we recheck. Hopefully negatif. Kalau still positif ya sama aja actually the treatment. Nanti after 6 months baru kita check. Mungkin And then barulah 6 monthly kita check tu lah to make sure tadi dah eradicated betul. Tapi usually lah 3 to 6 month. And then after that kan we go for secondary prophylaxis for 5 years ni kan. Nah, itu pun memang perlu jugalah selama 5 years kita prophylaxis ni betul-betul dia negatif sentiasa ketak. Usually we will check for 6 monthly SOT.
Doktor, kalau follow up untuk ARF patient, usually 6 monthly ke PCA?
Usually medication we will prescribe for 3 monthly lah. Paling lama, tak pernah sampai 6 monthly. 3 monthly medication follow up. But tadi for ASOT checking, ya 6 monthly. Boleh.
During follow up, doktor, kena ada buat ECG ke or repeat any investigation?
Jadilah 6 monthly SOT kan. Kalau no symptom usually 3 monthly ya just to prescribe another antibiotic. Ya of course clinically we assess kan, as long as no new murmur, no any issues, we don't proceed with any investigation. Kalau ada some finding for example you murmur, ya kita baru buat ECG ke another X-ray, echo lagi. Usually yang rutin for every 6 months ya tadi yang apa namanya ASOT. Kalau nak cek sekali dengan ESL CRP boleh. And one stop service sekali buat sampling. Even though kita buat 3 monthly apa namanya follow up pun tu jumpa kak klinik 3 monthly, tapi actually dia pergi mana farmasi kan monthly. Gua ada yang antar parents kan apa? Usually farmasi only give medication for one month. Unless kalau betul-betul stok banyak and then not limited drugs, usually sometimes some farmasi dia give sampai 3 months. Tapi macam UAE ini dia patient still need to come to take medication monthly.
Okay. Alright.
Okay, anything else about rheumatic fever?
Okay,
complication, prognosis ya depend lah, depend three groups aja. Kalau with apa namanya valvular heart disease, heart failure, ya poor lah prognosis, dia kena long life. Kalau yang this patient kan without carditis, most likely ya usually good prognosis lah, as long as discipline and compliance to secondary prophylaxis for 5 years. Complication apa, Aklan?
Acute heart failure, doktor.
Yalah, jadi simple ni lah. Ya, valvular heart disease, MR, AR, and then heart failure. Lain lagi apa?
Yang lain.
Active endocarditis.
Ah, fikirkan IE boleh. Misalnya kalau dah ada apa MR, AR tu, baru re-increases IE. Kalau tak ada apa without valvular disease ya actually risk of IE ya very low. So belajar sikit pasal IE sekali kan. So kan for example kalau pasien ni ada valvular disease, ada MR, AR, so increases of AI. So apa untuk management for to prevent IE apa? When we need to do prophylaxis antibiotic, is it long life? This patient memang dah ada lah prophylaxis antibiotic kan. Tapi yang dose prophylactic dose.
Pre-dental procedures, is it?
Yes, ada some procedure. Usually ya, surgical procedure lah, dental and surgical procedure. We need to give antibiotic for one short dose lah. Tapi prophylactic dose for IE tak sama dengan secondary prophylactic dose for rheumatic fever tadi. Kalau yang rheumatic fever tadi kan berapa? 250 mg/dL kan. Kalau yang pre-procedures prophylaxis to prevent IE, I think 1 gram kok. Kalau in adolescent macam budak nih, yang per dose per kg saya rasa sama macam dose terapeutik tuh, dia 50 mg per kg, tapi one shot dose. Jadi dose dia naik tinggi sikit. Alright. Apalagi satu manajemen yang penting. How to prevent IE. Despite kalau nak bu. Yes. Oral and as well as ya sama lah di Usually aurora tu both dental and tonsil. So kalau patient ada dental caries, ada chronic tonsillitis, patient like this must be removed. So ada je case-case-nya yang from Muazzam tu dia develop IE ya, karena banyak caries. Yang from Sungai Lembeng ada satu lagi hari itu, ini SDA lah. Dia develop IE ya. I think from tonsillitis, from kata saya lupa. Ya. Ada juga case yang actually Dr. Amir dah refer to dentist, tapi dentist dia cabut dia satu-satu. Takut sikit. So, jadi IE juga ada case. Kasihan juga. Actually kalau dah patient dah heart disease, ada high risk to prevent IE, oral hygiene dah ada cariesnya, baik cabut semua. Unless kalau the caries itu still minimal caries or apa namanya early stage kan ada juga apa macam my wife tuh dia apa prefer to save the teeth, so kena buat apa filling dulu buat tampal gigi. Tapi lah kalau dia poor oral hygiene, dia kita tampal pun banyak kali tampal, dia akan develop another caries and still increase risk. Usually itu lah, the safest tuh macam itu, supaya jangan sampai macam gitu, patient yang teramai satu itu. Dia dah beberapa kali datang dentist, ya tampal, ada yang cabut, tapi setelah ada caries, kena juga IE. Baik, terbaik kalau udah hard disease, ada caries, baik cabut. Ya. What more kan, usually kan, yang age kan, yang still apa namanya, primary teeth. Kalau primary teeth kan, cabut yes, no issue kan, nanti akan ada apa namanya permanentis akan keluar. Unless kalau dah macam ni 12 year old maybe dah permanentis kan. Permanentis memang nak tak nak memang kena apa kena save dulu nanti lah, kena fill, kena tampal dulu. Unless kalau dah poor hygiene cabut juga. Tukar gigi palsu. Tonsil macam tu juga, dia ada history of septal tonsillitis, ada apa nama, ada chronic tonsillitis, apalagi kalau ada snoring ya terus apa remove. Yang dispasien tapi tak ada lah kan, so tonsil tak payah remove. Oh iya lagi satu, possibly juga memang dia tak ada history of pharyngitis, oral hygiene tak ada report dan caries ketat. Because ada possibility juga actually the entry point dia, the port the entry dia bukan tonsillitis. Possibly juga satu vocal from apa namanya caries tuh, nama dia apa? Kalau sakit gigi itu bukan caries. Apa sakit gigi? Sakit gigi itu nama apa? Bukan gingivitis. Palpitis. Dia boleh from palpitis lah, from the caries yang infected caries. Tak tahu ya, aku lah tak, because you don't see the patient.
No, sorry, doctor. I could not
follow. Possible je this patient lah, tak nampak tonsil, nampak clear, faring nampak. Possible from caries lah, the streptococcus from there can easily enter the, apa namanya, circulation.
Sorry, yeah. I would like to ask regarding the prophylaxis antibiotic just now, if the patient had to undergo any surgical procedure like any surgery lah, so do we need to stop the antibiotic and then resume again ke macam mana tu?
Yang secondary prophylaxis? Secondary yes. Prophylaxis and never stop lah. You just maybe skip one dose kan, because tadi untuk apa IE prophylaxis prior to the procedure kan you give one single dose kan. Cumanya when we do IE prophylaxis, mana you can skip one dose of secondary prophylaxis. Tapi nanti after that, sambung secondary ya. Prophylaxis ya kena ikut lah. Kena every, kalau makan kan kena every day BD until tadi at least 5 years kan for this patient. Kalau IM ya dah cocok sebulan sekali ya. Tak payah kira lah, biar aja cocok sebulan sekali. Ada yang IM injection monthly kan, every 4 weeks tuh. Ya tak apalah, masa prior to procedures ya we give another apa one single dose for prevent the IE. Bahkan the apa namanya the aim lain kan yang secondary prophylaxis tadi to prevent relapse of staphylococcal infection. Kalau IE prophylaxis nih, prevention of IE ini ya to prevent the bukan staphylococcal infection tapi IE bakteria tadi dia yang apa staphylococcus apa namanya yang staph lah staph aureus strep dia strep apa namanya
viridan.
Viridansnya, Staphylidans, and then Hechik group, Haemophilus, Acinetobacter, C apa C? Corinae, Bacterium, E, lupa. K pun, K, K, Klebsiella. Nah, itu kan, apa, M itu lain, dia nak bunuh kuman apa lain kan. Kalau yang secondary prophylaxis, spesifik untuk Staphylococcus saja. Tapi kalau yang IE prophylaxis ya untuk bunuh kuman-kuman yang tadi untuk IE itu ya biasa more infective kan kuman-kuman yang lagi degil. Kalau pasien udah kena IE pun berapa lama treatment dia? Aklan.
Begitu.
Yang IE treatment antibiotik dia berapa lama?
Depends on either it is prosthetic valve or is a not natural valve. So longer for the prosthetic but for natural 6 weeks.
At least 6 weeks kan. Yang natural dia 6 minggu. Kalau ada prosthetic longer. Sampai berapa? Saya pun tak pernah. Maybe sampai sama ada sampai 12 week pun ada. Kalau tak silap. Maybe yang itu yang prosthetic. Usually yang common tu 6 week dia ada resolve. Okay.
But, I have a question.
Yes.
In one of the cases previously during third year, there was this patient with acute rheumatic fever, and then on a daily basis, the attending doctor actually assessed the patient's failure symptoms, even though the patients have no carditis to begin with. I ask, it is like, do we need to monitor for the acute heart failure even in cases of first presentation, doctor?
Kalau in time of acute rheumatic fever kan the process of inflammation still ongoing kan. So even though on day one on admission we assess no carditis, no cardiomegaly, no heart failure. But next day the inflammation can be worsening kan. So the heart failure can develop at any time. Usually itulah masa on eradication process tadi on acute inflammatory process in 10 days, but sometimes kan kalau patient very stable ya 5 days pun cukup. We monitor in the ward. Tapi lah sometimes kan patient ada yang 2-3 hari udah minta balik. Apalah kalau we are sure dia tak ada no cardiomegaly, no heart failure, and then the inflammation lah. The key tu inflammation lah. Kalau nampak dah tak demam. Usually kan at least 24 hours fever free. Kalau boleh 48 hours. Kalau usually kalau udah demam tak ada, pain dah tak ada, no active inflammation, so possibility to develop heart failure will be less lah. Kalau still ada pain, ada fever, still ongoing inflammation, still possible develop cepat lah. Yaitulah carditis terus heart failure terus at same point boleh. Memang kena daily lah monitor. Tapi kalau dah tak ada demam, tak ada sakit, ya tak ada carditis, ya okey lah. Will not develop heart failure.
Doktor, sorry. Untuk yang tadi Doktor cakap single dose for IE prophylaxis prior to the surgery, itu kan untuk semua ARF patient ke untuk yang ada carditis, initially had carditis?
Yang masuk, inilah masuk list of high risk IE patient. Kalau without carditis, no need lah. So at least lain kan, nanti you baca yang di URID dia apa, IE punya apa, pitch protocol tu. List IE dia, ya of course yang valvular heart disease only lah. Kalau yang without carditis, tak ada valvular heart disease, we don't need to give IE prophylaxis. Jadi yang high risk tu, list tu panjang lah. Inilah valvular heart disease. Bagaimana kalau with prostatic valve. And then yang usually yang kompleks lah, kompleks cyanotic tu, yang patient-patient yang cyanotic heart disease. Kalau simple apa, simple acyanotic macam patient ASD actually low risk. So ada apa in apa classification or stratification risk of IE itu kan ada yang low, moderate and high risk kan. Yang low risk itu actually ASD itu patient with ASD actually low risk. That's why even patient ada heart disease, ada ASD, actually no need to give IE prophylaxis kalau nak buat prosedur. Tapi itulah usually apa ada je pertanyaan ada tu apa masa in USM dentist nak buat apa nak buat extraction dia tanya berapa dos apa prophylaxis yang bagi je lah satu dos. Even actually ada if you know I'm not sure lah in apa in here our surgeon ni kalau in my place tu even the patient tak ada apa-apa pun every apa undergoing surgery dia buat aja satu single dose prophylaxis antibiotik. Kalau ini kat sini semua patient surgery bagi antibiotik tak? Ada je ya, sometimes individual juga ada yang apa surgeon yang tak kisah patient apa-apa kalau buat surgery dia bagi antibiotik. Actually lah if it is clear procedure apa clean procedure and then no high risk of IE tak payah bagi antibiotik pun sudah okay. Kalau ada high risk IE baru kita bagi antibiotik or kalau not clean procedure.
Doctor, can yes. We consider if this patient is female, can we consider psoriatic arthritis?
Septic, apa?
Psoriatic
tu usually kan apa Aklan?
Patient must have psoriasis first and then the patient have the joint.
Usually ada apa patient ada autoimmune disease kan ada allergic ada recurrent history of eczema ke apa-apa ke ya memang ada psoriasis usually. Kalau this patient kan it is new lah. Unlikely lah.
For this age group, doctor, is it possible to have such
psoriatic? Kalau ada je.
I mean like arthropathy, psoriatic arthropathy.
Boleh je, ada kan. Tapi memang compare to adult masih apa, more lagi jarang lah. Not that frequent than to adult. Tapi it's possible je, macam kita autoimmune. Okay. Well, kalau ada SLE ya senang je boleh jadi psoriatic. It's related with autoimmune juga. At least dia ada apa atopik kan ada apa atopik dermatitis. Tapi pun AD pun usually will only apa specific to eczema aja. Dia jarang jadi tukar jadi psoriatic. Kalau psoriatic memang dari awal pun dia memang jadi psoriasis. Okay. Nah, cukup lah. I think dah more than 4 o'clock. Dah 2 jam lebih. Yang another case nanti you present with other apa, lecturer lah. Alright. So, I think that's it. Maybe next week I will involve in apa bagi lecture masa neonatal teaching tu ada lecture. Alright. Okay ya. Yeah. So,
saya yes. Nak cakap pasal common lecture tu. Kamis.
Yes.
Supposedly Dr. Taufik punya time 4 to 5 pm.
Yes.
Tapi slot untuk 3 to 4 pm tu so far proper zaman dia cancel lah sebab dia ada hal lain jadi doktor awalkan ke macam ni?
Yalah. After that yang first Dr. Ismail ya.
Dr. Ismail medical kan?
Dr. Ismail Ibrahim ya.
Yep.
Alah, so after dia yang Dr. Ismail pakai apa dia? Pakai Zoom? Ke you yang arrange?
Ikut cari yang saya pernah, saya WhatsApp doktor yang sebelum ni. Yang buat two rooms tu.
So you all yang arrange ni? Tak apalah. So after Dr. Ismail habis ya, you inform apa? Kak Farah tu, Farah PA tau. You ada nombor dia kan?
Miswari.
So I will inform her as well to prepare the meeting room, team meet. Nanti after the Ismail finish ya, biar dia start.
Okay. 3 to 4 p.m. lah maksudnya slot doktor.
Okay.
Okay, thank you doktor.
Welcome. Alright ya. So, alright. So, let's close our session with us, Vicky Farah. So. Alright, so forgive me for any mistakes. Allahu a'lam bishawab. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, doctor.
Welcome.
Thank you, doctor.